Austin staff and a senior writer for Entertainment Weekly. Welcome to New York Comic Con. For almost 8 seasons now, Sophie Turner has played Sansa Stark on Game of Thrones. She's taking on probably the most iconic storyline in the X-Men universe, Dark Phoenix. EW did a first look cover on Dark Phoenix last year, and I actually got a chance to see I think it was 45 minutes of it. It's unlike any other X-Men movie, and it's great, it's emotional, it's tragic, Sophie just kills it. Let's talk about some Thrones, some Dark Phoenix, and if you watch her Instagram stories, I'd like to ask her about, and that's the tea. But anyways, please help me welcome Sophie Turner.
These two girls represent for me. And so I was like, I really need to up my game. She's seeing all these like amazing actresses. And so I went in and I was like, what's up? I gave her a big hug. I was like, high five after every take. And I was really like doing my best. I was super extra, but it worked. And like the minute I read with her, because I'd read with other RAs before, but Maisie was special and she is, and we just got on like that. And then ever since then, I mean, we walked out the audition and I said, I really, really hope you get this. And she went, I really hope you get it too. And we did.
What's a Sansa
Aria
like hangout? Like, what do
Maisie
and Sophie do like
nerf
for this?
Or,
like, maybe something, what's a
hangout for you two? I don't know what I can say. I mean, just like, we used to, I mean, they're kind of like loners on Game of Thrones, just because like the past few seasons, Maisie and I just really enjoy, we have sleepovers every night when we're shooting. Or every night whenever both of us are in town. And we used to just sit there and eat and watch stupid videos and smoke weed and our favorite thing used to be, I don't know if my pulse is improving. We used to like sit, we'd get high and then we'd sit in the bath together and we'd rub makeup brushes on our faces.
Of life or something, which is actually a movie, I guess.
Hey, toys in here for X-Men! It's very good. I'm Jess. So I actually watched all of that.
It's wonderful. I wonder if I
can find it. It's wonderful. What's the question? Well, we take a lot of precautions. I mean, the scripts, our names are changed as well on the pool sheets. We all have kind of aliases on the pool sheets. They stop putting our names on the trailers and just our cast numbers. And also we kind of have a drone killer. Like if drones fly above the set, there's like this thing that can kill the drones, which is really cool.
That's crazy.
Yeah, and
like a magnet or something? Like what is it? How is it?
I don't know how it does it. It creates like this field around and the drones just drop.
Also, it's very X-Men. It feels very,
X-Men. Yeah, it does. And also we shoot fake scenes as well. We got to costume and Croatia, we would shoot fake scenes because we know the paparazzi lurk around there, so we'd spend like half the day just doing nothing.
Wait, so can you say anything about season 8? Like this final season, can you say anything about Sansa's journey or Sansa, what she's up to?
I can say that Sansa kind of really I say this every season, but she really comes into her own this season in the way that the past few seasons for her, the whole series for her, she's kind of been somewhat lost, doesn't know where she wants to be, who she wants to be, who she wants to surround herself with. And this season she's very, very self-assured. She knows what she wants, she knows what she stands for, she knows who she wants to be around. And she faces threats to that this season, but we'll see how that goes.
And what was, was this, like, the last day, was that emotional? What was that like? Because this is 8 years of your life. I mean, you guys, you're such good friends, you know, you made huge friends from this. You guys come out so many life changes, you're all stars now. But what was that like to sort of say goodbye to this?
It was very emotional. I mean, I was lucky that my last day was surrounded by a lot of the cast members. We've been shooting the same scene for 5 days straight, so by the end of it, I was like, sort of finished. But it was like highly emotional. What they do is David and Dan, whenever someone raps, they bring out a storyboard of their favorite scene of your character in all of Game of Thrones. And they write like this really long note on the back, and I just like bawled my eyes out. I couldn't stop shaking and crying for hours. And it's still like I'm still processing it. Like it's basically the majority of my life. It's been nearly a decade for me, so it's. I'm still very much processing it, and I still don't really accept that it's done. I think I won't accept that it's over until next year comes around and I'm not back in Belfast with my family, and it's weird.
Well, now you sort of lose it, you've been cast now.
So, I don't really care.
It's funny too, because I was thinking about this. Did you ever talk about, like, when you were taking on Gene, did you talk to Peter? Did you guys like share stories about being part of the X-Men franchise or anything like that?
We shared stories about like going out to bars and what fun things we got up to.
Poutine, a lot of poutine.
A lot of, you know, those shots where you can like light fire and we shared stories about that. We both like Peter adores the cast, and as do I think they're amazing. But we did really compare notes. I mean, he told me what it was like to work with the director, the producers, everything, and he cracked me.
So were you, I think we talked about this a little bit for the cover story, but you knew that Dark Phoenix, like you were an X-Men fan as a kid, right?
I mean, my brothers were really kind of the X-Men fans. I remember them reading the Dark Phoenix comics, actually. I read a couple of them when I was really, really young, and I was just like, Jean Grey's the best. And then I watched the movies when I found out that they were auditioning for, for X-Men for the role of Jean Grey, and I started to get like a flurry of tweets saying like, you're a redhead, like you play that. I'm not, blonde, but it's fine.
That's a ginger profile.
Yeah, seriously. So I started getting those tweets and I thought that would be awesome to, you know, have something to go on to watch Game of Thrones that last a long time and create a new family, and X-Men is so amazing. So I rewatched all the movies and I loved it, and I thought Famke did such an amazing job as Jean, and I thought like what an honor it would be to be able to play Jean 2.0.
Did Famke reach out to you at all, or have you met her? Like, have you guys ever talked about this lady?
Yeah. I emailed her when I got the role, and I just kind of said like I admire your work so much. I really thought she played Jean in such a kind of balletic and heartbreaking and beautiful way, and I really wanted to kind of emulate that, put my own spin on it. And I said, you know, like if you have any advice, if you had anything that you watched or anything that you read to help get into it, like please let me know. And she wrote back and she said, you know, I'm handing you the baton. The role is yours. Do what you want with it. This is like a new thing for you. So that was a big honor. And then I met her at a party and I just kind of ran up to her and gave her a hug from behind. I was like, oh my God, fuck you. but yeah, she's really sweet. She's been very supportive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so when you got Jean for Apocalypse, did you go back and kind of reread the comics and kind of do kind of research on Jean and all the like certain storylines?
Yeah, I mean I probably watched the movies about 100 times. I was gifted one of the original Dark Phoenix kind of comics from one of my friends, so I read that. And yeah, I kind of did my research, but one thing that Simon wanted to really emphasize was the fact that, especially with Dark Phoenix, that like all of the other material, this is our, in terms of the movies, this is a whole new kind of movie. And so like, don't rewatch the movies for this one. This is like a completely different take on Dark Phoenix in terms of mood, a completely different take on an X-Men movie. So it's very different this time around.
Did you know that when you're in Apocalypse, there are moments where she's sort of Phoenix, it's a little Phoenix-y, in Apocalypse. Did Simon tell you like, hey, we're thinking about like the next one would be Dark? Like, you know, there were planning scenes for this.
No, I didn't. I mean, I she Phoenixed out a bit in Apocalypse. That's what we call it, Phoenixing out. She Phoenixed out a bit in Apocalypse, but I didn't think that, you know, it was like my first movie. I was like, the next movie is not going to be about Dark Phoenix. And so I kind of got a hint of it. I thought maybe like way down the road, I'm like X-Men like 25, or maybe do Dark Phoenix, but I didn't really think. It was only until about 6 months before we started shooting Dark Phoenix, Simon kind of sat me down and gave me the news.
What was that like? Because Simon's obviously a very prolific producer, and he's been sort of shepherding all these X-Men movies. This is his first movie as a director. This is your first kind of leading role. What was that? You're both sort of entering into new territory in some ways. It takes a lot of trust, I think, probably, for both of you.
Oh, a lot of trust. I think that's one of the things that I've loved so much about working with Simon. It's been so collaborative, and we're both kind of new to it. I mean, Simon's not new to it. This is his first directing role, but I mean, he's like basically directed a few other movies where the director hasn't always been. He's been a director for quite a while now. This was officially his first thing, and he is one of the best directors I've ever worked with. He's amazing. And it was very, very collaborative. He was very open to ideas, and if something didn't feel right, then we would spend hours and hours and hours for like 3 weeks straight just trawling through the script and like analyzing every single line, making sure that it felt right to him, right to me, and I think it does.
Yeah, I know, it really is, and I know how important it is to Simon, because he and knowing this too, you know, Summit wrote Last Stands, they kind of tried to do the Dark Phoenix storyline before. Did you feel, and Simon wrote that script, and I know he really wanted to do this story justice, did you feel pressure to sort of make it, because this is like probably the most iconic X-Men storyline, you know, around. Did you feel pressure to kind of take this on?
Feel pressure.
Like, it's terrible to do this, isn't it? Are you sweating?
Yeah, I'm nervous.
Yes, felt a lot of pressure. I mean, Simon, like, I knew Simon was taking out to lunch, and I was like, I wonder what this is about. It's probably just going to brief me for the next movie. And he sits me down and he's like, okay, so it's Dark Phoenix, no X-Men, just Dark Phoenix. I was like, but it's such an honor. I know that it's one of the most loved stories in all of the X-Men universe. And I mean, for Simon to trust me enough to kind of take on that responsibility was such a big honor, and I really wanted to, you know, do the fans of the Dark Phoenix comics justice. But of course, there was a lot of pressure, especially having been done before in X3. But the thing was that Simon will tell you is that it was very much like a beat of the movie, and Simon felt like it had to be, you know, the mythical part of the movie. So I was just excited to kind of do that story justice.
To set up this movie, so it's reopening in 1992, right?
Yeah.
And so the X-Men they're famous and they're beloved, which is different from Apocalypse and the other, like, Days of Future Past, which are sort of in hiding. So where is Jean in this, when we open the movie?
When we open the movie, Jean is a teacher at Xavier's School for the Gifted. And she is like a very loved teacher. She and Scott are in a very steady, loving relationship. She and Charles have, I mean, we kind of saw their connection in the last one in Apocalypse. They have a kind of, he's somewhat of a paternal figure to her, and even more so in this. She's in like a very secure place in her life, which is why everything kind of goes haywire when this cosmic force arouses. Arouses a rising! You know?
It opens basically with you kind of alluded to this, the X-Men go to space. This is the first time we've gone to space in an X-Men movie. What was that like to sort of to take that on?
That was fun.
Yeah.
It was really, I mean, it's something that we've never done in the X-Men universe before. It pushes the boundaries for all of the X-Men. It makes the stakes all the much higher. And it's just cool to take it somewhere completely different, because all of the X-Men adventures have kind of been, you know, on the ground or within the stratosphere. So this time it was really exciting. It made the stakes even higher, and the scene when they go into space is very tense.
Yeah.
Very exciting.
Yeah. And Sansa has been fairly kind of not passive, but she doesn't get in on the action a lot on Game of Thrones, whereas this, like, you're flipping cars, you're flipping, you know, helicopters, you're flying. How is that to be able to kind of get into, like, to stunts and stuff?
So, not many stunts done because I'm telekinetic, so it's really just this.
Do you stand in the meet, like, do you practice?
Oh, yeah. Literally, so many hours I probably spent in front of the mirror looking at myself. all the time.
So you do fly.
I do fly. Actually, that was fun.
Simon told you did not love it's called the parallelogram.
Yeah, eventually the reshoots we changed it to wires, which I was much happier about. We had this thing called the parallelogram. Which basically was like a seesaw, and they would attach weights to one end. I'd be sat, held up by a bike seat, held up by my crotch, and my feet were like dangling. And they would, I would just, they would push the weights down and I would fly up to about this high. It was like the least cool thing I've ever done. Especially because I had to have, it's kind of CGI hair, like Phoenix hair, so I would wear a bald cap as well. So like, it's like, when you're shooting these things, it's not cool, like you feel like a dick, like it's but in the movie it looks cool, and eventually we changed to wives, and it was a lot more fun, a lot more easier on the crotch.
What's it? So your scene partner, a lot of this one is Jessica Chastain, who plays the new sort of villain. She's incredible. The stuff that I saw, you guys have a great scene in a bar together where she's sort of this.
Did you see that scene?
Yeah. Where she's trying to like lure you over, and what was it like working with her? I mean, she's so cool, and in this, you know, we've never really seen her take on a role like this before, and I think it's just, she abused it with such sort of groundedness, I guess, but it's super cool to see these two kind of powerhouse ladies, like, kind of playing mind games with each other.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, it's like unbelievable to work with Jessica. Not only is she one of the best actors out there. She's also one of the coolest people ever. She really became kind of a mentor to me on set, which was kind of funny because that's kind of what she is for Gene in a way, and kind of paralleled that. In this movie, she's completely different from anything you've seen. I mean, she's the villain of the movie, but it's not gimmicky. It's very kind of eerie and very subtle, and she's not like, as Simon said yesterday, she's not like drilling her mustache. She's very haunting in this, which is amazing. And I would be convinced to go anywhere with that any day, which she tries to remove the gene. It was amazing. She is such a pleasure to work with, and she's a little prankster. I love it.
I know this one too, that was so cool when Simon sort of talked about this too, is that this one is very much skewed towards the women of the X-Men franchise, which I also think is, it's really a movie about Jean and Jessica's character and Mystique, in many ways, it sort of focuses on those three. Was that, I mean, especially in this day and age, if, you know, a superhero movie about female empowerment is super relevant and great, did that kind of make it more exciting to, like, while you're shooting it, to be like, oh, yes, ladies are... But just Jennifer Lawrence actually has a line in the movie, I think I showed yesterday, where she says, like, you should really call it X-Women, which we always end up saying, women always end up saving.
She says, you know, it seems like the women always save the men, you should be about changing the name to X-Women, and that's the coolest moment that I've ever read that. I think this is the thing about the X-Men movies, with some superhero movies, they can be kind of far-fetched, and they're complete superheroes, and nothing can touch them, but in these movies, it's, they deal with very real problems, like especially in the first few movies, I mean, they're completely alienated from society, they're a different race, people aren't used to them, they're mutants, they're despised, and then they're hailed as heroes, and then something goes wrong, and then they're kind of ushered aside again, and people don't want to hear about it, and they're locked up, and so they deal with kind of those like segregation, racism, but also, it's very relevant to today with female empowerment, and I think that's a really, really awesome thing that the X-Men movies do. So that's really exciting. And also in this movie, it's a lot about mental health as well. And that's why I was so passionate about it, because, you know, in my family there's been a lot of mental health problems, and so reading this script and knowing what I was gonna have to study in order to get into the head of Jean, which was a lot like schizophrenia, multiple personality disorder, reading the script and knowing that it wasn't done in kind of like a gimmicky way or making light of the fact that she has some sort of mental health problem was a really nice thing to read. And I think it's just a heartbreaking story about a girl who can't control what's in her head and what's within her. And she falls apart because of it. And that, I just thought it was fucking awesome to put that on the screen, and I was really excited to do that. So I think the X-Men movies are amazing for making things so relevant to real day life. And that's the great thing too, is you get the escapism of like, hey, I'm real rich. You know what I mean? And then you have these really real themes throughout, and I think that's why people quite resonate so much with everyone who watches them.
I mean, I think this one is so great. I think what's great about this one too is that the tragedy of the storyline is really honored. Like this one has very high stakes, and it is very a dark is a home movie that's called Dark Phoenix, but it has there's an emotionality to it that I think, you know, maybe some of the other ones didn't have as much. I mean, it still has the fun, you know, obviously you're on the space and there's, you know, Storm and Cyclops, but there's a sense of loss and emotion, and like Hutch Parker is one of the producers, and Simon were telling me that they sort of imagine this as sort of a very like a dysfunctional family drama in some ways.
Yeah.
Do you agree with that?
Oh yeah, this movie is very different to any of the kind of X-Men. It's more like, you know, we have Logan, which is more of like a Western drama, and then we have Deadpool, which is more of a comedy, and we're kind of smuggling these different genres into the X-Men world. And so this one is more of like a family drama, and it's much more character-driven, it's much more emotional. And I mean, take away the superhero, fantastical parts of it, it would still hold up as a really good movie. Which I think, you know, if you take away some of the fantastical parts from maybe previous movies, it's condensed down to like a half an hour of material. And so this one really holds up as a movie on its own, and then the superhero elements are just kind of big additions, exciting additions to it.
You have an incredible scene. This movie features Genosha, the community that Magneto Eric discovers. But I think one of the things that's so cool about your performance in this is that you have to kind of alternate between Phoenix and Jean within moments. So there's a scene where you go to you're talking to Eric, and you see her sort of fighting with Phoenix and seeing the shift. That was been so challenging to play, and not only play that, but also play opposite of Michael Fassbender. what was that like?
I mean, it's very intimidating to work opposite Michael Fassbender, because he's one of my favorite actors of all time. So I was kind of shitting bricks anyway. and then I having to do this, it's kind of like a roller coaster of a scene, because you transition from one personality to the next. And so we helped ourselves out by doing like a Phoenix scale, Simon and I, we wrote it down. And so in this one, it was kind of like 1 to 5. So that was okay. It wasn't too big a leap, but it's very difficult. It's very difficult to kind of maneuver. You just have to think that for something like, again, I say like mental illness, there's something inside you that you're covering up completely, but it's pushing its way out, and it's going to manifest, and it's going to show itself. And I think a lot of people can kind of relate to that. And then all of a sudden, she lets go. And with what we call Phoenix, Dark Voice, whatever you called it, it's kind of like a release for her. Like, finally she stopped, she just lets go, and it's almost like this euphoric thing for her to be able to be what this cosmic force wants her to be. I don't know if this makes any sense to people, but you will get it when you see the movie, I promise.
You guys, I mean, you are, this movie's very intense, but the one thing, because I was in some Apocalypse and Future Past, and you guys have a lot of fun. It's such a good group of people, and that's the thing that I think is so cool about this franchise, is that the X-Men, you guys hang out a lot in, you guys have a lot of fun though, right? Like, it's a great group of actors, and I just remember, like McAvoy and Fassbender just crack jokes all the time, Jen Lawrence is always, teasing them. Did you guys have fun though still? Just like the heavy subject matter?
I mean, I think we probably have more fun just because of the heavy subject matter. We just kind of distract ourselves. Oh my god, it is the most fun group of people to work with. I mean, every night we're doing like gang nights or something like that, or we're hanging out all the time, and it is, I mean, I feel bad for the first assistant director, Zadie Josh, because he has to like wrangle all of us, we're playing Truth or Dare on set, and it's just like, it's not a good time for him, but it's a great time for us.
We got some great questions from Twitter. Rafa Rayar, wanted to know, how is the relationship between Scott and Gene at Dark Phoenix? Obviously, Scott and Gene are a very pivotal part of this storyline. And Simon was saying to me, I think, for the cover story, that Scott's one of the few people that kind of stays on Gene. Gene, a lot of bad things happen in this movie, and Scott's one that sort of stays loyal to her, right?
Yeah. I mean, at the center of this movie, I think it's the relationship between Scott and Gene. There's a theme throughout this movie of Gene feeling abandoned over and over again throughout this movie, and Scott is the one person that kind of sticks by her through Gene kind of falling apart, and it's a really heartbreaking story for Scott, but also one that, you know, I think Scott's storyline deserved, because throughout the movies he hasn't really had like this kind of leading role in the movies, and this time like Ty steps up, and it's a really amazing storyline for Scott. I think fans of Cyclops would be really happy about that. But yeah, they start off as like a fully functioning, completely in love couple. They could get married any day if they wanted to, and things just start to go awry.
She starts flaming out.
Phoenixing out.
Do you think, at Dan Saris, wanted to know, do you think there are any similarities between Gene and Sansa?
Yeah, I think there's like a very much a vulnerability for the two of them. I think, again, throughout this movie, there's like this abandonment for Gene, and she's very much on her own. And I always see Jessica's character as a little bit of a little finger. Yeah, which is interesting. Maybe not as creepy as that. But yeah, I do kind of see very similar themes, and I think especially as well in Apocalypse, I remember thinking, you know, Gene kind of comes into this this world of you know, mutants and finding a home and this place that she had no idea what it was, what it was about. She was kind of thrown into the deep end of it. I think the same thing happened to Sansa in a way, thrown into a world of politics and manipulation that she was never expecting either, and then having to find their way through that. So there are some themes that I would definitely compare, but I think the biggest one is that they're both really fucking strong women.
And they both kind of, Charles in this, he basically, because Gene is so powerful, he's shielded her from a lot of things that she, a lot of things that happened in her childhood, and it is a very interesting, in this one you really kind of see the complexity of the relationship between, because he is a father figure to her, and it almost is like dysfunctional, like it's a weird family story, so it is sort of like Sansa in that regard too, that she, you know, she's got some family issues.
Daddy issues.
A lot of daddy issues. At Best of Sophie T wants to know, what is your favorite thing about this movie about Dark Phoenix? Can you bring it down to one? Can you whittle down to one?
One thing. My favorite thing about this movie. I mean, I really just think it's the fact that it's a much more emotionally driven, character driven movie than the rest. I think, you know, this would be, if it weren't for the superhero elements, it could be like a movie that went to like Sundance, Cannes, or something like that, like an indie, intense, dramatic movie, and that's something that I haven't really seen in many X-Men movies before, and so that really excited me about this one.
Yeah. I wanted to know, actually, you were at Comic-Con right now, obviously, do you like geek out about things? Like, are there things, like, obviously, there is such, you know, the X-Men universe and Game of Thrones have such fandom. What are you like? What do you like? Love? Like, what is like? What's your like? What do you like geek out over?
Well, that's kind of embarrassing. I mean, I love 90 Day Fiancé. Everyone's seen it. Oh my god, this is a
reality show. Wait, it's like, it's basically someone comes over from another. Is it from another?
country.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's stupid, but like when you're filming movies that are really intense, you need like a very live thing to come out and watch. And for me, it's a reality show with 90 Day Fiancé on TLC. And it's amazing.
Someone else was
told
me about that. I was like, I
want
to watch that. All
right, yeah, it's really good. And it's
always
Sunny
in
Philadelphia, actually. I love Sunny in Philadelphia.
So funny. Do you want to do like a comedy next? I think you should
go for comedy. I don't know. I mean, I would love to do a comedy, but I really don't think I would be good at it. I don't know. Some people say I'm funny, but I think I'm going to smoke up my ass. And in front of like a crew or crowds, like I can't be funny. Like coming out here in front of you guys is the most terrifying thing. I can't speak in front of people or improvise or like be my. I love your costume. Thank you. yeah, maybe one day I'll do comedy. I can't improvise though, so we'll figure that one out.
Who are the most like passionate fans? Thrones or Backstab we found is the more kind of like passionate fan base.
Thrones.
I think Thrones.
Yeah.
Woo! I've had 3 years of the X-Men fan base and I haven't really been at the center of the apocalypse or anything, so maybe I'll feel their wrath if they don't like this movie.
Has anyone like tattooed you? Like I've had
stories.
No, I mean like
someone
got like a Sansa tattoo.
Oh.
Like you were had a
fan
card like that. Or like
I've seen them online.
Oh wow.
You know, I saw one over summer and it was over that mole, so the mole was like in my eye. it's really weird. I've seen a few. I have yet to see one in person.
Yeah. So Fox is merging with Disney and there's all this talk that maybe the X-Men could work with me with the Avengers, like the X-Men and the Avengers could team up. Would you like to see, would you be down for that?
I don't know. I feel like the complexities of the X-Men kind of being shunned from society and all of that kind of segregation is not something that really happens in the Avengers universe. Of course, I'd like to see them cross over, but I don't know if the themes running through X-Men would then kind of collaborate well with the Avengers world. I think it would be very different. But I mean, if they do it, I'd love to see how it turns out.
These are two huge, Thrones ending and then Dark Phoenix is obviously just such a huge movie. What do you do next? Like, what's the next, are you taking a vacation? Or do you, like, what's the next role for you? Do you know yet?
I'm taking a big vacation. No, I am. I mean, I finished Game of Thrones about a month before I started reshooting this. And before that, I had been shooting X-Men for 4 or 5 months, leading straight to Game of Thrones and then straight into a few shoots. So it's been like a year and a half of not really a break. So I'm taking a long break. I haven't even started looking for projects. I love it.
How cold is it when you guys are shooting those scenes like in the snow? Are you actually in the snow ever or no? Is it always?
No.
It's all okay.
It's fake snow.
Okay.
It's fake snow.
That's a dumb question for you.
No, it's okay. It looks very real.
Yeah. Well, I always heard if you were jealous of like everyone else, like everyone's shooting like Sevilla and you're like, girlfriend. Like, I know you're like, why can't I go like the warm areas?
Yeah, well, I love Belfast, but it is not tropical in any way. There are times when you're like shooting outside in December and you're in these costumes that are dragging in mud and you're getting shot on by horses and you kind of think it would be nice to be elsewhere. But no, because the thing is then you go to like Seville or wherever it is and then you're sat in the boiling heat in these like cloaks and furs and everything and you're either freezing, you're either too cold or you're too hot.
Have a favorite Game of Thrones episode? Like, is there one that sticks out in your mind that you just love?
I mean, the last episode of the final season.
Were you like? I always wonder this too. Like, for the actors, when you watch them like the Red Wedding, are you as gutted as we are? Like, are you as emotionally like just traumatized as we are? Like, is it hard for you guys to even watch that kind of stuff?
No. Besides that, I mean, obviously, like, the performances are so compelling, and watching Richard die, like, seeing a good friend of yours, like, die on screen is never going to be a fun thing for you. But, I mean, you know all the tricks, and you know what the prop guys are doing, like, squirting this blood all over you, and the blood actually tastes really nice, a lot of times you put it. It's not really, it's not as dramatic as other people when watching it. You know, like, you know the props guys, like Brian is probably like making jokes about, you know, it's just, it's not that terrifying to watch.
Yeah. Do you have a favorite X-Men movie? Skinny Steve, or he's at Wolverine, yay, want to know if you can see Dark Phoenix, but do you have a favorite outside of Dark Phoenix?
Yeah, I think it was Days of Future Past. My favorite movie.
If you could be an X-Men, not G, if you could be someone else besides G, whatever X-Men would you be?
Probably Magneto. I think he's like the most complex of most of the X-Men. I think, you know, it's like him and Charles Xavier are like MLK and Malcolm X. Like, it's really, really interesting to see that dynamic and all of the hardships that Magneto's had in his past. You know, with the Holocaust and then with, you know, his family and so I think he's the most complex and most interesting one of all, except Jean.
Or Storm. I was always like ride or die for Storm.
I mean, Storm's pretty badass.
Yeah. She had a cape, she had cute hair, and she could like fly and shoot lightning out. I love that. I love Jean too is
yeah, that's right.
Yes, exactly. But I having seen this seen a bunch of it, you're really incredible, and I think you know, it's unlike an X-Men movie that I think any of you have seen yet. And I think loving the comics as much as I do and this storyline, you guys really do it justice, and I think it's viewed with such emotion and tragedy, and like you said, you really kind of you show this girl who's kind of torn apart by something. I think that's, you know, you should be very proud of you. Very, very good at this film.
Thank you.
But I just want to thank you so much. You're a delight. You're very funny. You should and I love your leather pants. But anyways, let's all thank Sophie Turner.
Come back.